Wow, it's been a minute since we saw you guys.
Do you know why it's been a minute?
Because we still had to recover. No, but like, no, in all honesty, I think for like the 2 or 3 weeks after Red came out, we were honestly just exhausted.
We were
like,
very that just took everything out of us. Unwell.
And like, do you think that I'm still well? Like, I obviously we haven't stopped listening to the 10-minute version of All Too Well on the Ball songs.
Simply
on Red.
Not.
Like, that's
simply
never stopped.
Believe that we have the best vaults collection ever. I mean, it's only the second one.
I know, but it's already so severe. I can't even believe.
But also, we've been talking about how like it would just almost be impossible for her to top that re-record because we got that 10-minute version of All Too Well. And but then there's like
the 1989. Fucked up. I actually cannot believe.
Well, we simply can't deal.
Oh my god.
But anyway, so we had to take a bit of time to recover
from
that.
We did.
We obviously had Christmas and like a lot of other stuff
going
on.
Happy New Year.
So yeah, Happy New Year. This is our first video that we're filming of 2022. However,
yes.
I will say, you might not be seeing it straight away because I'm not sure how it's going to go uploading this because every time I put a visual up on the videos, it gets copyright.
Yes.
So sometimes it can take up to 30 days to clear.
Oh.
Hello. Thank you for entering.
Yeah, thank you.
I just want to say that in case this goes up at any particular time.
It could be a little bit later than when we're filming, which is very early January.
Yeah.
Now that Taylor Swift is quiet again,
yes.
And maybe in some ways hope, but not hope at the same time.
Yeah.
We're in a bit of a lull and hopefully she's really not going to be fucking us up anytime soon.
Yes.
Like, we're still, I think, all recovering from Red. So while we're in this lull, we decided to jump back
and do some things. Yeah, we have
some things that you've been asking for a while that we just never did.
That we just never did.
So here we are. Long Pond.
We're back in our folklore era.
Yes. Oh, yes. Like, we were already confused as to what era we're in as a fandom. We already knew we definitely weren't in folklore era, but let's go there anyway.
We're definitely, if any era we're not in, it's folklore.
It's folklore. But let's go back.
And we have only watched this once.
Yes, when it first came out. So it's been over a year since we saw this.
So it kind of is like our first reaction. And I have just avoided visuals. We have listened to it because we've listened
many times.
But visually, and the things that she says in between with like Jack and Aaron and stuff, like, don't remember that.
Don't remember
and
that well.
The reason we've only watched it once is because we always said we're going to react to that. We're going to react to that again. We're going to talk about it again. So we always
put it off. Probably, like you said, like for the best that it's been over a year now, because it is kind of like an authentic original reaction because we just don't know. But we have obviously listened to the actual songs in it quite a number of times, and like some of the Long Pond versions are actually my favorite over the original folklore songs.
Yes.
So we will provide that commentary.
Yeah.
But I'm really excited to watch this again.
Same. I am so excited.
Really looking forward to
this for so long.
Uh-huh.
Before we get into today's video, there is something quick that I want to share with you guys. So me and Em have decided that we are going to make a little Patreon for this YouTube channel. If you want to donate to it, that would be amazing. Pretty much the reason we're doing this is because these videos are completely non-monetizable because it's copyrighted content.
Mm-hmm.
So there's no way of us making any kind of income from this. And I also make YouTube videos as my main job. But these videos are extremely time consuming.
Yes.
And if we want to pump out more of this content in 2022, we're simply going to need something to maintain that.
I think it's also important to note as well that, as a lot of you guys would probably already know, we are in the middle of trying to organize creating merch for you guys.
Mm-hmm.
And this would just be a really great way to possibly help fund some of that as well.
Mm-hmm.
As we're sort of getting off the ground with the creation of that.
Yeah. And obviously we love doing this. We love this as a hobby for us.
Yes.
And that's what we set out to do. But with the editing time and with like how much you guys have responded to the channel, we would love to spend more time doing this this year.
And at this point, this might be our only way of being able to do more of this if you know, we can take some time out, or especially yourself, because you're doing all the editing, some time out from editing your own stuff to make money.
Yes.
so that you can focus on this and still know that there is something that is going to be financially supporting you with this channel.
Yeah, and if this channel could financially support us in some ways, we could make way more content.
That's
for
true.
You guys.
Yes.
So, but that being said, the link will be down below.
Yes.
You can donate, like, as we're going to make it a very low amount. It's like, it can be like $1 a month mm-hmm. or whatever it is. If you guys really value our content.
Yes.
And if you would like to support us, that'd be a great way too, but no pressure.
Yes, exactly. Yes. Great.
Okay. We
possibly
are
halfway through this. I would like a cup of tea.
Okay. Yep. I fuck with that.
Okay, great. Look, a blessed album. Let's just start right there.
Oh, look at these woods.
Law, deep in the woods.
Deep in the woods. 2020.
Wow.
How are we already almost 2 years from that?
Okay, so it is 8:30 in the morning. And why am I awake, you ask?
Well, because it's 8:30. That's actually funny. Wait, I actually need to just pause.
I sort of unexpectedly started breaking.
Is 8:30 like an early time to be awake? Interesting thing for her to say.
It's 8:30. Why am I awake?
Yeah, like it's 8:30.
I think that tells us a lot. I think that sleeps in.
Well,
she's a late sleeper and a late riser.
Look, maybe this was the morning after she wrote
"Tis the Damn Season."
So, you know, she's just forgetting for a second that none of us know she was up all night drinking, writing "Tis the Damn Season."
Yes.
She's like, why am I awake, you'd be asking?
Yeah.
Well, because I don't know that's what you just did.
Yes. We didn't know that you just got drunk.
Please give us some information.
But
she can't give us that information because we didn't know that Evermore existed yet.
Oh, I can't believe she just wrote that while she was drunk one night. So absolutely offensive. Look at her with a little cup of tea in her
She's so offensive.
She's so cute.
I love this outfit too. The mustard pants.
New album. And at that point I was just like, I'm just writing songs in quarantine. And then it just became an album really quickly.
Can't believe she made Folklore. Like, I'm gonna have a whole meltdown during this because I haven't thought about Folklore in a second, and it's just absolutely ridiculous that she gave us this.
I can't believe that mug has the privilege of being against her lips.
You can't go into studios now because they're all closed, and I've never recorded anywhere else. And I know that other people do this all the time, so it's actually not that special, but I'm freaking out over it. We've built a home studio in my house, and so it's like I'm gonna do vocals today in my house. I'm very excited about it.
She's always so modest, isn't she? Like, she's always like, it's not that big of a deal. Like,
that's I think something that I've always loved about her.
Yeah.
Nothing about her screams I'm rich and famous.
Yes.
Like, not even remotely.
No.
Like, she's always been so down to earth, so chill and excited by things that you and I would be excited about.
Yes.
It's so funny that we're like a year and a half on from this being released,
so
and it's
cute.
Like they've finally been able to play it together. You could never imagine that it would still be going on now.
Right?
Yeah.
First woman.
Oh,
that's so weird. I think when lockdown happened, I just found myself completely listless and purposeless, and that was in the first 3 days of it. And then I remembered when we met a year before.
I would just die to know what her daily routine is.
Oh,
like, is she like, I first of all, I've always said to you, I want to know what she has for breakfast.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
I think I would ask her that if I could ask her, because it's not invasive, but it's like, I want to know.
Same.
But just like, what the fuck does Taylor Swift do on a daily basis? And if she has 3 days in, I feel like she's very kind of like, she's a very productive person. Like, she always has to be doing something.
I agree. I feel like she's like fidgety and like just wants something
to do. Yeah, and
has
to work towards something.
Yeah.
Hence why Folklore happened, even in isolation.
Like, we knew that they were in lockdown by like April 2020. So she met, I guess, about that time, April 2019, that she met
Aaron.
Which is so interesting because April 2019 is when she released Me, which was moving into the release of Lover.
Yeah.
And just how different that whole different era was.
I know.
Like the fact that she was planning like Lover Fest and like this big tour and everything, like there was never any there wouldn't have been a moment where she would think I'll be working with you within the year sort of thing.
Yeah.
Like,
I know. I think that's what makes Folklore just so magical is that it happened
so
in
organic.
such a random organic way. And I think, like we know this now, but like it was the first time we really got to see what Taylor Swift would do without the expectations, without the pressure to make a single or to make a tour or whatever, to be a pop star really.
Well, this is why I think that we can all agree objectively speaking, that Folklore is her best album.
Yes, yeah.
Like, even though, like, sometimes I agree and sometimes I don't.
Same, yeah, yeah.
It's still, like, what she did there was so different and so organic compared to anything she'd done before. Yeah. Even though she was true to herself always in past albums, but getting rid of all of those expectations and, like, writing songs for a purpose and stuff.
And she could have so easily let that crumble her because, you know, Lover Tour wasn't going ahead. Like, I know that I've had things like that happen before and then I just feel paralyzed. Like, I can't continue on. And she somehow managed to put that aside and do something so unexpected.
Yeah, with Folklore. She really just accepted pretty quickly that the Lover thing was not happening.
Yeah.
And was and able to move on and release that rather than, you're right, like holding on to, oh, but you know, like things might be all right by the end of the year and I can still tour Lover. She and like, I don't want to, like, you know, release another album and then have to jump back to a different era. Like, she just did it.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And that could have been really. That could have gone bad. I think for a lot of artists, it could have gone badly. But for her, it just obviously was such a perfect thing to do and has just really cemented her in, like, that legendary status, I feel.
Yeah,
like, this I agree. Album really...
This elevated her to a different level.
Yeah, I mean, especially, like, winning Album of the Year that third time and just... Everyone was just so
everyone's fucked up by Folklore.
So
even non-Taylor Swift fans were fucked up by Folklore.
Yeah, it was such an amazing moment.
It was.
I think it's really important that we play it. I think it will take that for me to realize that it's a real album.
Mm.
If we're going to have to recalibrate everything, we should start with what we love the most first. And I think that was what we were sort of unconsciously doing with this.
Totally. Yeah. That is so it, exactly. If everything's going to fall apart, then make a record.
And I was so glad that we did because it turned out that, like, everybody needed a good cry as well as us.
The One is just the most perfect opening track.
I know.
Look at her cute little shoes.
I know, I love her shoes in this. I also love that dress shirt thing.
Jack! Oh, he's so iconic. Yeah, the three of them just do this.
I know.
I'm doing good, I'm on some new shit. Been saying yes instead of no. I thought I saw you at the bus stop, but then though.
Her voice has never sounded better.
I hit the ground running each night. I hit the Sunday matinee. You know the greatest films of all time were never made.
Oh. So how does she look like that?
I don't know. I simply just don't know.
Her hair and makeup are perfect in this
here,
whole
set. But so simple. Like, it looks effortless.
Yeah, perfect Folklore vibe.
Yeah.
Also, like, just having a moment with the fact that this is Aaron's, like, studio. Like, this is where he always is making music. Like, that's so
which is
iconic.
A lot. It's such a perfect place. I love
so
where it's located and, like, the scenery around it.
Yes.
And, like, just the whole vibe.
Absolutely.
I also am just, like, immediately emotional that I don't get these visuals forevermore.
Oh, I know.
Like, watching this and I'm like, oh, that's right.
Imagine if we had, like, champagne problems live. And cowboy like me.
And Ivy?
Wait, I'm so emo.
I know.
It's actually really cruel. It's really
so cruel.
And, like, I know, like, she doesn't have to do it, but at the same time, like, she did it for Folklore. This game
is Evermore is just a forgotten child, and that's the way it is.
So superior.
That's fine. We will not forget her.
Never.
I know.
Sounds like that.
I feel like you captured the spirit of the whole record with that song.
Oh,
one in
she looks so good here.
Okay, first of all, we need to say that shirt is from Free People.
Yes, it is. Yes,
I actually really wanted to buy it after I saw it.
I know. She looks so good in it.
I'm doing good. I'm on some new shit. Saying yes instead of no, and I was like, is she talking about writing songs with me and everything else at the same or something?
I think it has a new meaning. I think it has a double meaning. The opening the album with the words "I'm doing good, I'm on some new shit" and saying yes instead of no, it
it applies to the situation that the song is written about, where, you know, you're updating a former lover on what your life is like now and trying to be positive about it. But it was also where I am creatively, where it's like, I'm just saying yes, I'm just putting out an album in the worst time you could put one out. I'm just making stuff with someone who I've always wanted to make stuff with as long as I've been a fan of The National. And
it's exactly, it was so refreshing hearing that as the first lyric, along with the new
in the middle
sound,
of a pandemic, yeah. Yes. And there was so much, I mean, there still is, but there was so, particularly so much uncertainty at that time, like right at the start.
Yes.
That it, like she said, like everyone just needed a good cry and like, but some hope as well.
But some
and
hope.
Folklore was
and
just
a
like
shift. It's something different, like something really, really different. And
Folklore was just like, if anything good is going to come from
yeah,
this pandemic, it's
it
this.
Was that. And you know, you're right. We would not have Folklore and Evermore if it wasn't for the pandemic, which
no.
is crazy to think.
I also the love
different
watching
reality.
Yeah, right. I also love just like watching her talk about this stuff because like I don't feel like we often get, especially with Longhorn specifically, because she does go into a bit more detail with every song.
Yeah.
We never get that with every song on an album.
No.
Like she never like breaks down like some of those lyrics and I'm so sorry. Wouldn't have known that otherwise.
No.
If that's how she thought about that.
Yeah,
lyric, that it's
yeah.
got a double meaning and stuff.
Which
you know?
Is so true. Like it's actually really hard to know how she is thinking about a lyric when she says it because, you know,
well,
there's so much
her
room
lyrics
for interpretation.
Are fairly vague.
Yeah,
and,
yeah.
Like, you know, how I interpret it or you interpret it or, like, even, like, what we might agree on as, like, a friendship group or whatever.
Yeah. Someone
she
else
could be thinking something completely different.
Yeah, yeah.
I would like to know what she had in her mind, even though that's not the point. And, like, obviously songs are great because they can be left open to interpretation
it's
and, like, applying
really
to your own life.
To hear her talk about it, which is
yes.
why, like, imagine the things. She's barely ever spoken about Evermore. Like, imagine the things that we could uncover if she did a Long Pond or
oh.
something similar.
Cute.
Aaron just looks so, like, chilled.
Oh.
That piano. Wait, can I just say that piano's? He makes it look so fucking easy.
I know.
We tried to learn it.
Yes, yes.
We tried
it's
to
so
learn
hard.
At the beginning. Did
it, and did even it, us playing it together was still hard.
I was
like,
doing
we weren't
one.
Even playing both parts, and it was hard.
You were doing the din 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 din, and I was doing
and
the
din 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 din.
Cobblestones. When you are young, they assume you know nothing.
Oh, that was rude.
Oh my god, I'm so sorry. I have to say as well the fact that she's wearing the plait here and also like posted in that like woodsy kind of vibe, that picture where she said not a lot going on at the moment again.
Yeah.
Which when she released Long Pond like the following week, we thought that was all related. But actually the plait and that were in relation to Evermore.
Yes, and
we didn't know.
And because in that photo she had the willow tree.
Yes,
and
she
the
did.
Honey.
So like when she was promoting this, she fooled us all.
I know.
Fooled us all.
Fooled us fucking all. How dare she?
Even her wearing a plait here is kind of just like,
yeah,
I know Evermore's around the corner and you bitches don't know.
Thought of that. Did she wear the plait the whole way through?
Yeah.
Wow.
Well, other than when she's talking, but in the recording parts.
That's a
very
good point that I completely forgot about.
Yeah.
Vocals really just are something else. And I remember Jax, I think he might have was in this or he says it somewhere where he's like, when we were recording Folklore, I was amazed at Taylor's vocals. So many of the takes were just like in one go.
Yeah, I can't remember if it's in this or not, but I do remember he said that.
And
like,
you know, it's like the best she's ever sounded and whatnot.
Yeah.
And it really is. It's just like she just her voice has improved so much to this point where it's just. And, you know, that's why I love Taylor's voice so much. It's like, it's not this show-offy voice that I feel like I get over. Like, I always want to hear her voice.
It's just normal, again. But it's
beautiful.
But it's beautiful. Like, she can sing well. But it's
the
not
tone of
extravagant.
It, yeah, the tone. It
feels
relatable or
it feels,
something.
Yeah, I was, it feels down to earth.
It feels down to earth. How dare Aaron make this? How dare she make this song? This is the second or third best song she's ever written.
It is now third for us.
Yeah, it's third for us.
Can't believe a child's gonna come out of her one day.
That's not what I was about to say. That is fucked up. I don't
want
to think about the fact that some blessed human is going to be her child.
It's a lot to think about.
So fucked up how unfair the universe is.
I know.
But also just like, I love how much she is feeling these songs. I mean, she's always been an amazing performer, but even when she's just sitting down, you can't take your eyes off her. Like, she feels the song so much in her expression and in her being that you just...
There's not a lot of other artists who I would sit here for an hour and 45 yeah. minutes and watch them sitting on a couch singing yeah. their songs.
Yeah. No, but Taylor, obviously with her tours, like, everything is so, rehearsed and perfected. Like, she just doesn't miss a beat.
I know.
I never miss a beat. I'm landing on my feet. Oh. And that's what they don't fucking see.
And that's what they don't see. This bitch was saying it in 2014. And
she's like, you don't even get it.
But, like, she said that in 2014 and yeah. I only just fathomed that in this moment.
Yeah. Mm,
that she, like, knew that.
Yeah.
She's like, people don't respect my stage presence.
No, they
she basically
don't.
Said that. But this keeps happening. This keeps happening. She has so much wisdom in her songs and, like, I know that.
Yeah.
But it's not until something happens yeah. or, like, 10 years down the track that I'm like, oh.
Yes.
I actually knew that.
Yeah.
Because Taylor's have told me yes, that I didn't know it to like live it.
When she's on the stage, you can't take your eyes off her, in my opinion.
And that's actually not, wait.
She's singing down here.
I'm really fucked up by the fact that you just brought up those Shake It Off lyrics. It's actually really bold and like confident of her to be like, oh, let's go something straight.
I never
miss a beat and I am lightning on my feet and you bitches don't see it.
It makes me think of that video when she's on the 1989 tour. Those boys come to grab her leg and she lifts up her leg and then, like, almost dies because these two people dived at her. And then she just turns around and fucking keeps singing Bad Blood or where the fuck it is. And I'm like, she's such a pro.
She's such a pro.
Sorry, what were you going to say?
No, even the fact that she says, I make the moves up as I go. She's such like, I am the music industry and I make my own rules. Like, I'm gonna surprise release Folklore in fucking 7 years, 6 years from now, and you bitches don't even expect it because you just don't even, like, you completely underestimate me.
Wait,
this she's is been telling us for years that she's like, do you realize that I don't follow your rules? I do whatever the fuck I want and it's amazing.
I just am dying over you having a full moment with Shake It Off right now. And it's funny because it's Shake It Off and we're listening to Folklore.
I know.
They're like connected. That's how good of a songwriter she is.
Aaron has nice hands.
Aaron just is nice.
He is. That's
so
true.
Fun. Oh god, this is such a blast.
Oh,
she's a real damn blast.
Why do I feel like she should have taken that audio and added it to the end of Stay? Because she says that was so fun.
Yeah.
That was a real blast.
Oh. This is different. This one.
No, it is. You're right.
I had been wanting to write a song about Rebecca Harkness since 2013.
Stop this illegal talking.
And I'd never figured out the right way to do it because there was never a track that felt like it could kind of hold an entire story of somebody's life and whatever and move between generations or whatever. Then when I heard that, I was like, oh my God, I think this is my opening. I think this is my moment. I think I can write the Rebecca Harkness story.
that song is such a folklore moment to me because it's not about you, but it is all about you.
Well, it's that, like, country music.
Jack
Antonoff, ladies and gentlemen.
Speaking.
He definitely needs to stop speaking.
That is exactly what... That is exactly, we've talked, we could talk about it forever.
We could, we shouldn't.
But we will.
Yeah.
No, but Last Great American Dynasty is actually just something else. I can't believe it exists. And it's also the song that Taylor Swift commented on under our TikTok, so it's fine.
The Last Great American Dynasty will forever remind me of Taylor Swift telling us that she loves us.
Yeah, yeah.
Like forever. Like forever. I hear the opening chords and I'm like, Taylor Swift told me she loves me. Like, it's all I think about now, and I listen to the Last Great American Dynasty.
Same, I love that.
I love that it's that song too, because, like, that song never. In fact, do you know what? That song needs to enter my top 20, and that's a fact.
That song definitely is in the
top 20. Wait, we were talking about this other day, how we always are so surprised because when a new Taylor Swift album comes out, we have songs that we, like, are obsessed with right at the start, and then some of them do stick around as our favorites, but some of them really drop.
Yes.
And we could say that about Lover, Folklore, Evermore. Yeah. Like, there are songs that at first we're like, and then now we're kind of like, actually, there are other songs that have
taken over.
And, like, been a lot more consistently.
What was that song for you on Folklore?
On Folklore? well, I feel like the last great American dynasty has risen. Like, same. I didn't realize at first that that was going to be one of my consistent favorites on the album.
Top five.
Same.
Top five.
I feel like The Lakes dropped for me.
Yeah.
And this is, like, all to say that, like, every single song she's ever written is perfection. Like, don't get me wrong. But, like, yeah. I thought I would be obsessed with The Lakes forever. And I'm like, actually, there are songs on Folklore I prefer.
Yeah. For me, it was Mirable. When I first heard that, I thought it was just simply the best song I've ever heard. Mm-hmm. And it is. Mm-hmm. But, yeah, there's other songs that
have both said this about Invisible String.
Yes!
We both were obsessed with Invisible String, thought it would be a favorite.
Yeah.
And that's kind of dropped as well.
Yeah.
But I feel that about, like, every, like, Nobody No Crime has dropped for me.
Yes, Nobody No Crime.
And songs like Cowboy Like Me and stuff have risen, which I didn't realize at the time. Mm-hmm. And on Lover, I really thought Afterglow was going to be
a long
moment.
I was going to say Afterglow was our one on Lover.
Yeah.
That definitely that dropped.
That has dropped.
Bit, yeah.
And same with I Think He Knows.
Yes.
We were both obsessed with that when it first came out, and actually that's dropped quite a bit.
Yeah.
Compared to what
Cornelia Street rose for me.
Cornelia Street?
Yeah.
It rose.
Yeah.
100.
Anyway, back to Last Great American Dynasty. Jack summed it up perfectly. It's nothing to do with her, but it somehow also still has this thread of her underneath it and the two stories relate to each other so perfectly.
Well, the second you realize that she's talking about somebody who lives in the house she now owns, you realize that the only reason she's singing about Rebecca Harkness is because she relates to her so much. And so the whole story is about her in some ways because she relates to Rebecca so much, which is so fucked up because you don't even know it halfway through the song.
No, exactly. It's just, the first time I ever heard that song was one of the best moments of my entire life.
Oh my God, right?
And I'm so glad we had that captured. And then Taylor Swift.
And that's what she told us that she loved us because of our reaction to it. Oh! That's
this
a lot.
Song is
device where in country music it's like this guy did this, then this woman did this, then they met.
Nobody
and
their
kid was me.
Totally. And I was that man.
Which is the best. It's like you listen to country songs and you're just like shivers everywhere, my whole body.
That turned into such a good meme. Shivers everywhere, like, my whole body. But that was us when we first heard that it was bought by me.
Oh, right.
Just absolutely.
Like, didn't know it was leading there? Oh my God.
Someone else. I think it's the most revealing thing. I think it's so deeply personal. And it really hits you in the gut when you hear that at the end.
Thanks.
It's real good.
Man.
Love him.
Oh,
thank you. Use your fingers.
Yes. The tapping is Jack. Yes. The tapping is important.
It's important.
I just have to say one more thing. I'm sorry. I love that. I love that she said that I was waiting for the music that could tell this story because I completely agree. There's something about the music of this track that is just, what else could you possibly write about in this song?
And like, I don't think that I have heard another Taylor Swift song from the past that I feel like, or even an album where I feel like a song like this would have fit on it.
No. Oh my God, here we go about the William Bowery.
The two co-writers were here. Justin Vernon and William Bowery.
Justin is one of the great.
Jack's so silly in this scene. He's like, who?
William. I never got to meet.
There's been a lot of discussion about William Bowery and his identity, because it's not a real person.
It's not?
A bit. That would have gone on forever.
What?
Who?
When?
So, William Bowery is Joe.
Oh my God. Do you remember when we screamed? Joe
plays piano beautifully, and he's always just playing and making things up and kind of creating things. And Exile was crazy because Joe had written that entire piano part that dun 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 dun, and it was singing the Bonnie Bear part that I can see standing, honey.
I can't believe Joe wrote that. Like, it's just so fucked up that she's ended up in a relationship like this. I love that for her so much.
I do wonder, like, if he ever was inclined to sit down on the piano and, like, create things like she's saying. Mm. Like, before he was in a space where she was doing it a lot. Like, I wonder if that was something he did before the relationship.
Totally. Like,
obviously, he's known how to play piano, but whether he was, like, creating stuff himself
songs,
and whatever.
Yeah. Like, I wonder if he was inspired by her.
Yeah.
because obviously then they continue to go on and
write. Well, she would just constantly be sitting like at the piano or like on her guitar, just like kind of doing stuff, and like being around that a lot might have inspired him to just sit down and be like, let's just see what happens sort of thing.
Look, when you're around Taylor Swift, God knows what inspiration God knows come what out would happen. Of you.
It That's
would
be, true.
I think that they both have like made each other shine in such beautiful ways, and I feel like this is a perfect example of like how their relationship makes each other flourish. Is like they're so creative together, and they kind of push each other to new heights.
We're really, really, really big Bon Iver fans, and you know,
so cool.
We know that Aaron knows him, but I was too afraid to suggest it. But I just when I sent it to Aaron, I was like, this is hopefully a duet. We I don't know who with who would it be with. Who do you think would be good with this? And Aaron was like, I think Justin would love this.
You're like, really? Okay, that could be interesting.
I couldn't say it. I couldn't say
really?
It.
Is that really what happened?
No, I couldn't say it with words, because if I would have said it and he would have gone to Justin and Justin would have said no, it would have hurt too much.
It's so funny, even coming off like what Aaron just said before, he was like, you know, is this a real text? Like every person that's ever gotten a request from Taylor Swift to do a duet, like Phoebe Bridges
obviously
said it
too. Like, yes.
She said when she got Taylor Swift's message, she replied saying, I've been waiting for this all my life.
Yeah, yeah.
And then like she still gets so cute and like insecure about people wanting to work with her, like almost like she doesn't think that some people take her seriously.
Well, yeah, like, and I think that it's like it's a valid insecurity given that she has always been in that like poppy kind of, and she's always been like the young, like girly singing about love. Mm. And you're right, like people not taking her seriously. And also, I think maybe some of that insecurity comes from like not having a lot of friends in school and being bullied and stuff like that. Like her assumption is not that people are gonna love her, even though that's her reality today.
Yeah,
she's probably still a little bit stuck in those insecurities, as we are all stuck in our insecurities, whether they serve us or not.
Like he just is on the album, and he's just the coolest, and that's what's happening.
Oh, he sounds so fucked up in this.
He does sound fucked up in this. Wait, I'm actually really intrigued to watch this again with his part there.
Yes.
I can see you standing.
I actually don't understand how he sounds like that.
Laughing, but the joke's not funny.
It's actually, that change in key is rude.
Well, actually, Exile is extremely different the whole way, even the bridge and how they sing that.
Yeah.
It's really
and I
different.
Really, I quite like it. Like, I like being able to listen to both versions and them being, like, fairly different from each other.
Yes, I love that change that he did there. I wonder why he's wearing that thing over his
face. I was going to say, that was why?
Is it because you think he's around people where he feels like he needs to wear a mask? Or do you think he doesn't like to show his face, especially because he knew how many people would watch this?
I don't know, like maybe there is some insecurity there, or just like a desire to hide his face like that, but like it's not like we don't know what he looks like. Like he performs on stage with his face.
But like, maybe he feels like, because it's Taylor Swift, like so many people are gonna see it, that he wants to like hide his identity a little bit. I don't know, I'm trying to think of why he would be covering his face.
It
like
is
that.
Interesting.
If you guys know, please let us know.
Yeah.
But I love all of the small little intricate changes throughout this performance in their vocals, and I think both of their vocals are just absolutely stunning.
They are.
And it took you 5 whole minutes.
He's very covered with the hat as well.
He's very covered. Super interesting.
I think I've seen this film before.
That little hand.
And I didn't like the ending.
So step right out. There is no amount of crying I can do for
all this time.
That's different.
Yeah, which is superior. Echo straight away in this version.
Yeah, they're singing together.
They're singing together.
Yeah,
I like that.
Because normally she doesn't come in there that early. Normally she just does the echoes. And they're singing this whole bit together. So it's completely different vibe, and I love it. I do.
Same.
It's like she goes down too.
Yeah, I love that bit.
Yeah.
microphone and it makes that echoey sound.
Yes. I find it such a mind fuck when they change up the melodies and the lyrics like that in a song, because I'm like, how did you already think of one really amazing way to do it and then you
do it again?
Somehow thought of a different way.
I know.
That is not obvious to do what they just did. Those little small subtle changes, like, how did you come up with
that? I find that really hard. Like, when I hear a song the way it is recorded, that's all I can hear most of the time. So whenever anyone performs a part of it slightly differently or in a different key or whatever, I'm like, oh,
I don't. And obviously she does that again in My Tears Ricochet.
Yes, yes. Offensive.
Where do we start? I mean, to me, the whole thing starts.
I love that outfit.
His chat's so offensive.
Mm. Yeah, chronologically, that's the first thing. I wrote that one alone, and it's definitely, I think, one of the saddest songs on the album.
Yeah.
I feel like it's so great knowing that she started this album with My Tears Ricochet. I love knowing that information.
Yeah. Well, it just really gives you insight into how she was feeling during the pandemic and like reflecting on how sad she was that she lost her records.
Yes.
Having that whole vibe to start the album.
Absolutely. And it was just such a core of the album for that reason. And then Jack is about to say here he thinks it's one of the best songs she's ever written, which I completely agree.
Yeah. I think it's one of the best songs you've written.
Oh, thanks.
Which is, I think, why you crowned it as a track five.
Yeah, picking a track five is
I love that he
sort of a pressurized decision that I knew from day one this was probably going to be it. It's kind of a song about karma.
Yeah.
It's a song about greed. It's a song about how somebody could be your best friend and your companion and your most trusted person in your life, and then they could go and become your worst enemy,
not going?
Who knows how to hurt you because they were once your most trusted person.
The worst betrayal.
Yeah. Mm. It does remind me of people going through a divorce and having that person that they swore to be with forever then become the person that they spend most of their time talking shit about.
Yeah, and it is that ultimate betrayal when someone, you know, messed you up from the inside.
Mm-hmm. Writing this song, it kind of occurred to me that in all of the superhero stories, the hero's greatest nemesis is the villain that used to be his best friend.
Yeah.
Mm.
They're both great, but sometimes you write like very in the moment.
Yeah.
And you're like, this happened and this is how I feel. And I love that.
That's coming in here.
This song, which is interesting that this is the first one that happened because I think it became a huge theme on the album, is it's very pulled back.
Mm-hmm.
It's very pulled back and commenting on the whole experience of it.
Mm.
It's very powerful to me.
The piano in this version, no, I'm so sorry. This is the superior song on Long Pond of the Long Pond Studio Sessions songs.
Yes.
Cannot believe that this version exists. It's my favorite. Love it. Can I also just say, I find it really interesting because I know that she doesn't normally ever talk about who her songs are about, but I find it really interesting that she completely avoids even talking about the fact that this is about losing her records.
Yeah. She hints at it, but she's not direct.
Well, even he just said, you know, like this was kind of like the beginning of like the whole theme of the album.
Yeah.
Because that is the theme of the album.
Yes.
But they still don't explicitly say it.
No.
And it's like, I don't know, I find that interesting. Like maybe she just didn't want there to be any more drama or shit wrapped up in it and obviously keep it so that it is a bit more vague. Like how she said it reminds her of a divorce.
Yeah.
Like, because it allows other people to attach their own experiences to it and relate to her a bit more.
Yeah.
But then I also feel like that's such a true experience for her, especially with the theme of this album.
Yeah, I think it is. I think it's interesting that she didn't say it, but I also think it makes sense in the way that maybe she just didn't want the drama. And like, I think that she made it obvious with saying like, it's like the betrayal of like, you know, a best friend or like someone
who's
like been family to you and then like turned their back on you and did something horrible. And like, kind of said it in different ways. Cause I think like if she had maybe said, this is about me losing my albums, it would have been like perceived as like a real attack.
Right at the end, like after the last line, she does this like and I'm like, that just fucks me up. Like, she really is just like, I'm dying singing this song.
But I also just want to say, I love that Jack was just so on the same page with like her emotions there. Like, he can wrap up how she's feeling and why the song is amazing. Like, he was just getting so emotional towards the end there, like just being like, yeah, it's so good. Like,
we gather here, we line up.
Love the way she says fire there.
It's different.
And you're the hero flying around saving.
Wait, that's actually key. Mm. I never made that connection between what she said about, like, you know, in, like, those, like, old comics and, yeah, like, superhero stories about, like, the villain having once, yeah, been the best friend,
yeah,
and her saying, you're the hero flying around saving face.
Yeah.
Look at
how my
tears ricochet. Look at her face.
I know. This is so mad.
Oh, my God. You can see her, you're right, scathing.
Yeah.
But just really feeling it and the anger in behind her face.
She's just so good
She's
at expressing.
She's in this song.
Yeah.
Him out in this song, and you know, it, again, it's even interesting what she said before this song too, like, because she's basically saying, like, this person is now my worst enemy.
Yeah,
that's a lot for her to say.
I know
that's a lot for her to
say. She is so mad, and I absolutely am here for it. You're right, that version is so interesting because it doesn't have, like, a real change in the when the bridge comes in, but the piano is just building and building.
Yes.
Which Jack plays so perfectly.
He does.
Emphasis, you can really feel it. And she's also holding, like, that same kind of tone and key throughout the whole thing, like, without going up and down like she does in the original with this.
Yeah. In the bridge.
You know, I still talk to you when I'm screaming at the sky when you can't sleep at night. I love how she sings that bit.
Yeah.
When you can't sleep at night.
I know, she's fucked up. Offensive.
Offensive. I can't believe they did this.
I know. What the fuck?
We love this bit as well.
Oh, yes. Look at this new addition.
She really spells it out at the end there.
Mm-hmm. Look at all my tears ricochet. Illegal.
That's
illegal. That's an illegal version of that song.
I love that she added those bits on at the end. And this is what makes live performances special, is there's a little bit different, something else that they bring to the table. I can't even begin to think of the offensive things that she would do if she ever did Evermore.
Oh,
and that's what hurts.
That's what hurts. It's like, think of the versions of these songs that we would have. Like, I need to hear how they strip back Ivy.
Oh, I can't handle Ivy.
Do you have a favorite from the Long Pond songs?
I think it would be probably Exile.
Okay, yeah, interesting. Yeah, that's valid, yeah.
I also really like Illicit Affairs.
Yes! I prefer this version of Illicit Affairs.
Yeah, the
Illicit Affairs over the original as well.
Something fucked up.
It is, you're right.
Mirrorball, sometimes when I'm writing to an instrumental track, I'll push play and I'll immediately see a scene set. Mm. They are broken a million times and that's what makes them so shiny. We have people like that in society too. They hang there and every time they break, it entertains us.
Yeah.
And when you shine a light on them, it's this glittering, fantastic thing. But then a lot of the time when the spotlight isn't on them, they're just still there up on a pedestal, but nobody's watching them.
Well, it's a myth we love and then we create it for people.
Yeah, it's the whole,
like, do the broken thing,
do
make
the
it
broken
fun,
thing.
Now make it sad.
Yeah.
Now make it cool, now make it sad.
Yeah, but when the light's off, be okay.
Yeah.
It was a metaphor for celebrity, but it's also a metaphor for so many people who have to feel like, everybody just feels like they have to be on for certain people, you have to be different versions of yourself for different people. This is the first time in the bridge saying they called off the circus, burned the disco down when they sent home the horses and the rodeo clowns. I wrote this song right after I found out all my shows were canceled.
Mm. Wow.
And it's like, I'm still on that tightrope. I'm still trying everything to keep you, to get you laughing at me. So it's like, I realized here I am writing all this music, still trying
And I know I have an excuse to sit back and not do something, but I'm not, and I can't, and I don't know why that is.
But that's what makes it, to me, a great piece of pandemic time work, is that it's not about the pandemic, it's about the experience of what happens to an artist when you're living through a pandemic.
Mm. Yeah.
That's such crazy thing for him
to say. That is a fucked up thing to say.
I love when Jack Antonoff does that. I love when he speaks. I love when he wraps things up. Mirable really is... God, it's an incredible song.
I know.
The metaphor in Mirable is one of the strongest metaphors in this whole album.
I like watching her say that again because I feel like sometimes I forget.
Yeah.
Like what it is like that she, like where she was exactly writing from when I listen to it sometimes. Like the way that she just summed that up then.
Yeah.
I'm like, yes.
I see a lot of people say that they relate to this song. And at first I was like, oh, that's interesting. Cause like to me, I felt like it was a very clear metaphor for fame. Like I feel like it feels like a fame kind of metaphor to me. But then also there is that other side where she kind of talked about it just then, and this song is her talking to the fans in a lot of way, in a lot of ways, and kind of
even her just saying like what she meant when she started writing the bridge, and her just like, I'm still trying everything to keep you laughing at me, like that has to be a direct talking to the fans.
And I also find it really comforting her saying like that whole like hush when no one is around, my dear, I'll still be here, like on my tallest tiptoes, like making music for you guys, like doing this, and she
Mirable really is offensive
and Folklore was a perfect example of that. She still kept making music.
It was almost like a summary of what Folklore was.
Yeah.
For her.
Yeah.
Like in some ways it explains the entirety of its purpose.
Yes. It does.
Or where she went in that pandemic.
Where she went, and he said, it's a perfect piece of art for that reason, because it's not about the pandemic. And I think Folklore is perfect in that way. I don't think anything really references the pandemic, except a little bit in Epiphany, but that's still perfectly in the
way still
that
perfectly.
She does that.
It's not like we're all gonna get sick. Like it's like.
I would love to see you try and make that into a Taylor Swift song.
I could never write a Taylor Swift song. There's zero chance I am writing the most ridiculous songs you've ever heard if I ever wrote a song.
That was so funny. Oh, Jack's doing some
fancy. I also love this version of this song too.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know if I prefer it, but it's like on par for me.
It's a little bit clearer because the production on Mirable is quite thick.
I agree. Listen to Mirable enough.
Yeah. It's a really fucked up song.
It is. Like, listen to this. I don't know another song that sounds like this. This is fucked.
It's so fucked. It's like getting a hug from Taylor Swift, this song.
It is. Yes, it is.
I love that she does the hands.
Yes. I also love how she used that lyric as the caption when she went to the Brit Awards. Was it the Brit Awards?
Yes, it was.
And that was like over a year later.
Yeah.
No, it wasn't quite a year later.
Yeah, everyone was like, what are you doing?
But I loved that. She looked like 1989 with the red hair. Yeah. And we were like, what's coming next? Yeah. And then she like spoke about Mirable in the caption. Love that. That guitar that Aaron's doing.
There's just three guitars happening.
I know. Well, actually, what's in Mirable in the normal version?
Well, I think there's a little bit of production. Like, I don't know, maybe like electronic production. I don't know.
Some sounds.
Do you think like I know?
No.
I am not a genius.
No.
But I'm really like, I can't believe it's just three guitars making this sound right now. Guitars are a magical instrument.
They really fucking are. But who needs a beat? Who needs a beat? No one.
No, not in Mirable. We do not need a beat.
Don't need a beat. I'm still trying.
This song.
I know.
But like, I just can't believe how how vulnerable those offensive lyrics are as well. Like, I know we've talked about this song at least 3 or 4 times in the video now, but, like, it's just fucked up how, like, vulnerable she is even there to admit that she wants to keep you laughing, keep you looking.
Which is another why releasing this album was a super brave thing of her to do, because it was her most vulnerable album, even though she's always been really okay with releasing vulnerable songs. Like, this was, like, a this has been trying. Hello?
This is, like, a whole, an album of track fives.
It is. I know. Actually, I meant to say that before when they spoke about My Tears Ricochet being a track five, because I was like, it's funny that she knew from the start that this was going to be, that My Tears Ricochet was going to be track five, right, because every song on it is so vulnerable.
Yeah. Everything. I left my phone. Oh, well, we don't need it.
To be a chicken with you.
Throwing a massive tantrum in a grocery store. Like, part of me is like, man, I feel you. Like, when did I stop doing that when I was upset? Like, when did I stop being so outraged that I would throw myself on the floor and throw the cereal at my mom?
Also, it doesn't stop, but where does it go?
Yeah.
Feeling. Like, we're still having that feeling, but...
Yeah, so the idea is...
Why does he just say the most fucked up things?
Why does he say these things? I actually can't handle him.
He says so many offensive
things. Well, that is why processing your emotions is so important. Yeah, we're not saying... Obviously, throwing a tantrum is not a good thing, not something we want to be doing as an adult. But we have to process those emotions somehow.
And where do they go?
If you're not processing them, where do they go?
Yeah.
They turn into anger. They turn into rage. They resentment. Turn into resentment. They turn into fear. They
anxiety.
Turn into anxiety. I love Jack Antonoff.
Please picture me before I learned civility. Mm. Like, I used to scream.
And it's always been one of my favorite lyrics.
Obviously, you know, we can't be throwing tantrums all the time, and we learn that that's not the right thing to do. But there's something lost there, too.
Mm. This is why I wanted to watch this again, so we can see all the offensive things they say.
And you know, Seven... I'm so sorry, I have to say it. Seven already always has felt like the core of folklore to me. Not just because, not only for any other reason other than the fact that I feel like it's a pure example of folklore. It's her telling these stories and passing down lessons through this song. And I find that really special.
I completely agree.
The lesson here is to hold on to that, those feelings, those childlike feelings, and to remember what that felt like.
Yeah, that's so true.
Yeah. Mm. Sometimes I forget, like, what the real meaning of Seven is, and it kind of is that...
I don't even think I've ever... Innocence. I mean, obviously, other than probably the first time I watched this, which I can't remember.
Yeah.
I don't think I've ever really thought about it that way.
Mm.
And that's so true. It's like, remember that you have these emotions that you had growing up, that you, like hold on to them and continue to feel them in maybe a more healthy expression of that emotion.
What you just said there really reminded me of how I've been fathoming lately that different people's favorite songs on albums are really just because of their own, like, way of viewing the song or their own experiences that make them connect with the song in a different way and hold a different meaning. You can never really judge what someone's favorite song is, because, like, apart from, you know, when we talk about, like, there structurally being something about the song that we love, like, everyone's connection to that song is different for a different reason.
Yes. Exactly. So it's perfectly valid why they love that song, and maybe why you don't understand that.
Yeah.
Rude. I love to see the fingers from the top.
Yeah.
Said before, I don't know if I've said it in a video, but you and I have spoken about, like, if an artist chooses to have a long musical outro, there is a reason for it, and most of the time I feel like that reason is you need use this time to reflect on what you've just heard.
Yeah, absolutely. When a song is as superior as this, it just feels right. It needed to go to then.
I agree.
Thank you for honoring the feeling. Oh, here we go.
Can I go straight into it?
To work with you. And now Aaron can understand it. No, I'm serious, because it's like, here's the song. Oh, wait, here's the bridge. Wait, here's a better bridge. Okay, now it's a perfect bridge. And then here's the thing after the bridge. This thing's going to come in.
Okay, remember when I pulled the
bridge? Yeah, so like,
I wrote that in the vocal book.
Yes.
Yeah.
So there's a series of...
Just in case you come.
So like,
I do remember her saying that.
That's so fucked up. help for her to say, what do you mean she wrote? Are you telling me that there was like an option for that to not happen? And then she was
recording. Yeah, I think she wrote it on the spot. Well, sung it on the spot. Yeah.
I don't think I knew that.
Really?
Oh my god.
No, I did retain that information from the first time I watched.
Oh my god, she is just too much for me to handle. I love that Jack is talking about this as well, like the writing with Taylor and how like it's kind of chaotic but uh-huh. amazing because she's just constantly coming up with shit. Mm-hmm. That's what it must be like to be in her brain.
I just love what you did on that song.
Thanks. I love what you did on that song. And I've been kind of in my head like calling so the girl cute. From August either Augusta oh, or nice. Augustine. Well,
I love how after this everyone just went, it's Augustine. Like no one went with Augusta.
No, absolutely.
Like everyone's like Augustine. Like I feel like on Twitter and absolutely. Stuff, like I see no one ever referring to no. her as Augusta, but definitely Augustine.
Augustine's so much prettier.
It is yeah. Augustine.
I'm glad
it's
she
cute,
said,
isn't it?
I'm glad she said Augustine after that.
Same. Yeah.
In my head, I think Betty and James ended up together, right? So in my head, she ends up with him, but he really put her through it. But like, August was obviously
I'm
about
so confused.
The girl that James had.
Wait, I need to say something about that.
Yeah. I disagree. I don't think Betty takes James back.
See, I think a lot of people do disagree.
Yeah.
And I don't think that my mind initially went to, I think they stay together. Mm. But I love that that is how she feels
yeah.
because I then it tells me about her.
Yeah.
And what I feel like it tells me is that, and this is probably true even of her earlier songs, she has always romanticized and accepted like that those types
turbulence.
Of love that can be, they can have turbulent and
yeah.
toxic parts to them, but you can grow to have a healthy, fulfilling, like,
relationship.
Long-term love.
Yeah. You know,
like, it's just
true.
Interesting for her to say, like, you know, he really put her through it, but they ended up together.
I think
I'm
she
like,
loves to
that's
believe
interesting.
In true love, and I agree. I think that... That is really beautiful that she does think that.
Yeah.
I think also I was listening to Lover this morning and I was thinking about all the times she references like them having fights, and it's actually like she actually references it quite a few times.
Well, this is why I say that in the album Lover, I feel like she really like is vulnerable in the sense that I feel like we really get to see a lot of her toxic sides in a relationship. Like that's interesting, you know, and I feel like it makes you, it is relatable. Like,
it is relatable, yeah.
Because but she's not a perfect human.
So she seems like she's a bad girl, but really she's not a bad girl. She's like really a sensitive person who like really fell for him. So the idea that there's some like some bad villain girl in any type of situation who like takes your man is actually a total myth because... That's not usually the case at all. Like everybody.
Think about the growth that is from like Better Than Revenge.
Right. And
which
that's why I
think,
have always loved August because yes, there is obviously cheating is wrong.
Yeah.
There's a
feeling.
Person behind that. Like it's not just the other girl in any situation. Like there is somebody's feelings involved in that.
That whole song started with the fact that I had written down in my phone, meet me behind the mall years ago, wanting to write it into a song.
That's fucked up to know. I remember when she said that, we were like, what the fuck?
That's crazy.
Freaking
adorable.
Offensive. I know, Jack, playing August is the best thing ever.
Okay, this is me trying. Right, here we go with the tears.
I've been thinking about addiction, and I've been thinking about people who, if they're either suffering through mental illness or they're suffering through addiction, or they have an everyday struggle. No one pats them on the back every day, but every day they are actively fighting something. But
and it's so hard, which is what I get from that song, when you're doing your damn best and it's not good enough.
Yep.
It binds us all together, the fact that we are all trying. And I think that that's such a nice way to look at other people as well, as everyone is trying their best with the tools that they have been given.
Yeah. I also think in some ways it doesn't bind us together, because I think it's really easy to forget that other people are trying their best every day. And like will, it's easy to see what they've done wrong or why they're being annoying or like, why the fuck did you say that? Or like all that kind of thing. And it is so easy to forget that people are actually trying in every moment. Like you said, with the tools that they've been given throughout their life.
Yeah.
I think there are a lot of mechanisms for us in our school days, in high school or college, to excel and to be patted on the back for something. And then I think a lot of people get out of school and there are less abilities for them to get gold stars. And then you have to make all these decisions and you have to pave your own way, and there's no set class course you can take, and there's
That's so true, and I've never thought about it like that.
No, you know what? I actually have, because I've seen people say before that, like, sometimes, like, the high achievers in school end up the most fucked up in life because they've grown up in this environment where they can be rewarded for their efforts, but in life is not like that, and they struggle without that, and that's perfectly valid. Yeah. Like, if that's what you've based your life on and what has gotten you through your life, all of a sudden to then be thrust into the adult world and then just be like, everyone just expects you to get up and go to work, and everyone just expects you to do your job well, and like and that.
School is so structured, and then like if you don't have like life afterwards is so much more open and random, and you don't have the path laid out for you a lot of the time.
Totally.
So
and I think even relating it back to
I love that she's written about that, or she's considered that in this song.
Yeah, I forgot as well that she kind of had said that like the first verse is separate different. To the second verse in like
almost
what
like
the...
telling different kind of people's stories.
Yes.
Yeah. That's
illegal. You're doing two at the same time.
Autobiographical, because I think I felt like I needed to do that, and I felt like fans needed to like a strip from the headlines account of my life, and it actually ended up being a bit confining because there's so much more to writing songs than just what you're feeling in your singular storyline. And this was the first time that I ever was like, I think it was spurred on by the fact that I was watching movies every day, I was reading books every day, I was thinking about other people every day. I was kind of outside of my own personal stuff. And so I ended up just like, I think that's been my favorite thing about this album, is that it's allowed to exist on its own merit without it just being, oh, people are listening to this because it tells them something that they could read in a tabloid.
Oh, that's so true. It really did open the doors in so many ways for her in that way. And I think why she loves this album so much, because she feels freer after being able to explore something so different.
Especially given how successful it was. It's like that validation of like, oh, I can write about something other than me.
And people will love it. Yeah.
Like... Almost more than anything I've ever done before, which is crazy.
Because she's such a good storyteller. Like, no matter whose story she's telling, she manages to tap into that emotion just the same. And I love that she's going to be telling other people's stories more, because I think that that's just more opportunity for people to relate to different kinds of experience.
Totally. She's tapping into a lot more experiences for people, which naturally brings on more people who will love and appreciate her because all of a sudden she's writing about experiences that they relate to that maybe they've never related to a song she's written before.
Absolutely.
Can I even begin to fathom the things that we're going to hear from Taylor Swift in the future? What?
It's so exciting to be alive at the same time as her.
I know.
It to me feels like a completely different experience.
It was.
You're absolutely joking with what he's doing on that guitar. I
know. How does Aaron make these sounds?
I don't know. Put over your head, keep your eyes down. Tell your friends you're out for a run.
You'll refresh when you return. I can't believe she made this song.
No, neither can I.
No, it's simply unwilling.
Unwilling. Oh, and then she goes and she's like,
yes, this is a superior version.
This is a superior version. I also prefer this.
Yeah. You show me colors you know I can't see with
anyone else. Oh. You know, this song is obviously not about this person, but I feel like off the back of like exploring the whole Jake thing again with Red Taylor's version, I feel like even re-listening to that song, I'm like, there are a lot of emotions that I feel like she'd relate to in a relationship like that.
Yeah, don't
which makes it
don't
so yeah, like, and it makes it so like, I love that, like, even in her fictional writing, obviously it's easy for her to tap into emotions she's experienced.
Absolutely. I just love this human so much.
Oh, she's so illegal.
Oh.
So Invisible String, when I first heard the track that you sent me, I thought, this, I have to write something that matches it. And pretty quickly I came upon the idea of fate, because sometimes I just, you know, go into a rabbit hole of thinking of how things happen, and I kind of love the romantic idea that every step you're taking one step closer to where you're supposed to be, you know, guided by this little, like, invisible string.
And that was another moment where I just felt there was this serendipity happening between us. And
he is just so cute. I feel like every time he talks about Taylor, he's like in such awe of this experience. Like, you can tell that he doesn't even quite realize like what the fuck has happened.
He's still unsure of what the fuck has gone on in his life. Like, I love that he was the only one that tweeted about Evermore.
I know.
Him and his offensive guitars.
I particularly love that Jack is playing on all the tracks with them, even though he didn't work on all of them. Like,
I agree.
They haven't got someone else to come and play guitar. That would be so fucking offensive. Like, I'm so happy that the three of them were like, we're going to perform this whole album together. It just feels like a band.
I agree. And I'm sure that would have been true if she ever did something similar for Evermore. Yeah. Jack would be there, even though he only contributed to one song.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know? Well, two.
Two,
Ivy.
Yeah.
But yeah. That's an offensive guitar.
Sound, yes. That was beautiful.
I love how this immediately go into the next thing. Like, thank you for not fucking around.
The red on the rocks and the red on the house.
Actually, yeah.
Thing you had written, I just felt like it's got these sort of ominous strings underneath it, and I was like, oh, this is female rage.
Oh, we were so fucked up when she said this.
It's amazing.
And actually, that's one of the few things that stuck with us from what she said in this originally.
Absolutely.
The fact that she said Mad Woman song, like, the musically sounds like female rage.
It does. That's exactly what it sounds like.
How dare she say that, though?
I know. How dare she say that?
It's so true.
And how dare he, like, make a song like that that sounds like that?
Oh, and this is also why you know that Aaron and Jack are superior men, because I don't think that any man with any trace of toxic masculinity would feel comfortable contributing to a song like this.
Yeah.
You know, like, because you would just be offended.
Yeah, absolutely.
And they just know what the fuck is going on. Look at his cute little face.
I know, look at his face.
He's a chicken.
Like, I have to figure out how to make this about female rage. And then I was thinking,
the most rage-provoking element of being a female is the gaslighting that happens.
Can I just quickly say back on that? Like, it's amazing how much Aaron inspired Taylor throughout this whole thing as well. Like, yes, he would send her tracks and she would write over them, but, like, the sounds that he made inspire her.
Yes, like it's only because of him that she got to these topics and to these songs.
Yes, it's such not a beautiful collaboration. Not just
because of
the sound, but
because of what they inspired in her, like you said. Yeah, totally.
It's so great how their chemistry has worked and how beautifully that's come. It's all come together and like, and he's amazing.
He's so amazing. I know, he's actually incredibly talented. Like it's alarming.
It's so alarming.
Alarming. Like, not a lot of people walk this earth with this much talent.
No, and Taylor knew it. Taylor was listening to this song. She's like, "Are you fucking kidding me that you just got these tracks here?"
Literally.
That she could just do these things with.
Literally.
You know, for centuries, we've been just expected to absorb male behavior silently, right? Silent absorption of whatever any guy decides to do.
Look at him nodding along. We love a feminist man.
We do.
In our enlightened state and our emboldened state now respond to bad male behavior or somebody just doing something that was absolutely out of line and we respond. That response is treated like the offense itself.
That's so fucked up for her to say.
That is exactly how women were treated. Literally, all of a sudden we started saying, no, your behavior is not okay, and we were deemed reactive and crazy.
You're so used to women being like nice all the time that if the second that they're like emboldened, like she said, or empowered, it's like that's a threat to you, and you find her to be like a bitch or whatever. It's like that's not even the truth. It's just like you are so used to women just like bowing down to men, just accepting it,
being kind and soft and gentle. This song is so fucking good,
so deeply offensive.
I have no right to respond, or I'm angry. I have no right to respond, or I'm out of line. So you providing the musical bed for me to make that point that I've been trying so hard to figure out, how do I say why this feels so bad?
That's such a fucked up way to put what Scooter does. Yeah. Because, like, on what planet would you think that she wouldn't respond to the fact that she no longer owns her music?
Yeah.
Her response to losing her records is the offense in their eyes or his eyes? Not.
Why are you reacting like
not
this?
What you've
my God.
Done.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. It's absolutely
infuriating.
The whole situation is so.
Female rage. What even is that sound that's happening?
I think it's a harp, is it?
Is it? It kind of does sound like a harp.
I don't know, I could have just made that up. Maybe it's just the piano. Oh, it's him on the fucking guitar making that harp sound.
Him. Every time you call me crazy.
Look at her face.
Cannot. Like she probably would know if he ever had affairs and stuff like that. So she's really like calling him out.
But she does it in such a poetic way, which she is does. What's so fucked up about it. She's not sitting there being like, "You cheat on your wife, you scumbag." No. Like she says it in the most fucked up way that you can't even. There's nothing you say to that. There's nothing you can say to that.
Same energy as we're all gonna get sick.
Epiphany.
I love this version of the album because we were towards the end of it and it was all very piano and acoustic. And you're so good with string arrangements, and you know, Bryce is, I mean, a genius. And I kind of felt like there should be a moment where there's a song that was unlike anything I'd done before, and Father Who Fought in World War II at Guadalcanal, which was an extremely bloody battle, and you know, he never talked about it, not with his sons, not with his wife. And then when I was thinking about that, I realized that there are people right now, you know, taking a 20-minute break in between shifts at a hospital who are having this kind of trauma happen to them right now that they will probably never want to speak about. you know?
That is crazy that she put those two concepts together and mm-hmm. somehow wrote about it in such a perfect way, because Epiphany does just have that kind of, it's a feeling, this song.
Yeah.
And it's almost an inexplainable feeling, which is amazing that she kind of matched Aaron's feeling there as well.
It's fucked up that it's Epiphany just is amazing. Just about trauma in
yeah,
general.
Yeah.
Really.
It just blows me away time and time again to really think about the two of them coming together and what they manage, how they managed to meet each other with the music and the mm-hmm. lyrics and the meaning, and mm-hmm. just it all so perfectly.
With this album, like, there have been times in my life where things have fallen apart so methodically, and I couldn't control how things were going wrong, and nothing I did stopped it, and I felt like I had just been pushed out of a plane and was, like, scratching at the air on the way down, and, like, I felt like just, like, the universe is just doing its thing. Wow. It's just dismantling my life, and there's nothing I can do. And this is a weird situation where ever since I started making music with you, I felt like
that is just a wild thing.
That was like the universe forcing things to fall into place perfectly, and there was nothing I could do. It's one of those weird things that makes you think about life a lot, where, you know, this lockdown could have been a time where I absolutely lost my mind. And instead, I think, you know, this album was like a real flotation device for both of us.
Oh, yeah, that was a fucked up thing for her to say.
That is completely fucked up. Everything she just said was so illegal. Falling out of the sky and scratching at the air, like, reminds me of Reputation and falling from the cliff, climb back up the cliff and all of that. And it is amazing because I feel like her life just slowly broke down like that and has slowly been rebuilding in the same kind of way. Like she said, like, in this really perfect, like, universal way, everything's just falling into place.
Well, I feel like that's true of everyone's life. Like, whenever things feel like they're completely falling apart, there is usually always a silver lining. It's just that you can't see that yet.
Yeah.
That the only reason that you ever get to a place where you're super happy with where you're at, you only got there because everything fell to shit at some point.
Yeah.
You know?
Just one single glimpse of Philly to make some sense of what you see, make sense of what you see. I like
that's
that
rude.
Change.
That's so rude. Yeah. I forgot she did that.
Yeah.
He's like,
that's completely illegal. It's the little sounds. Betty.
One of my favorite things about this record is the fact that there's this trilogy of three, the trinity of Betty, August, and Cardigan are all like, we made August together, Jack. We made Cardigan together, we all three
it's perfect.
Made Betty together. Yeah. And Betty was, I just heard Joe singing the entire fully formed chorus of Betty from another room.
Yeah.
And I just was like, hello.
Like, I do this professionally.
Hello.
I'd love to have a conversation.
It was a step that we would never have taken, because why would we have ever written a song together?
I thought you were doing a bit when you're like, Joe and I wrote a song. And I was like, what? And I thought it was going to be like, you know, like people write like cute songs about their animals. And then like, I don't know, we wrote like a real song.
I don't think you ever underestimated Taylor Swift, Jack.
I love Betty. Betty stuck for me as one of my top five as well. About that, sorry, I need to keep talking about that.
No, that's
what I love about them talking about, you know, how they wrote that song and how Joe had the fully formed chorus of Betty. I love that even though Joe had that concept and that whole chorus there, it was actually Taylor that made it Betty, because
yes.
You know, Betty was...
Well,
Betty,
the reference to Betty James and Inez was not part of that chorus.
No, it was not, and Betty wasn't even part of that chorus, and I think that it's really special how those two things came together and how the verses really formed that song in a way.
Yes.
It really sets up the chorus. It's
and
amazing
even the
that
perspective
she was able to do that.
From a teenage boy... Because that's not obvious in the chorus either. That could easily be from a female's perspective. There's nothing in the chorus that indicates a gender at all.
I should have at your party. Yeah, it's just an apology, isn't it?
And it's just an apology.
And then Taylor brought in all the context around the apology and connected it to the other songs. And I just think it once again shows her genius in slotting that song in and giving and making it make sense and giving it so much.
She did. She made it what it was, even though it's an offensive chorus that Joe wrote.
Oh, it's
like,
a great chorus. Yeah, it sounds great. It's a great chorus. But what Taylor then did with it after that is so interesting.
Simply illegal.
Simply
illegal.
Simply illegal.
Mm-hmm.
I need to know what foundation she uses.
I was literally thinking that before. It's so matte, it's so and I love it. Now that you've verbalized it, I do simply need to know what foundation she uses.
Yeah.
I really want to know.
Yeah, same. I really want to know.
Can she do like a makeup routine? Yeah. Oh, if Taylor Swift ever did like a...
One of those Vogue.
Like a Vogue. Oh. Yeah, like skincare routine and then like into her makeup, I would simply pass away. That would be my most watched video on YouTube.
Same. Ever. I need her to
I would
do
study that and I would
like
buy
that.
Every single thing that she uses.
Every single thing that she uses. It's actually rude that she's never done something like that.
I know, I actually hate it. Like, talk to me. It's no skin of your back to tell me what products you use. Like, it's really not difficult. Come on.
It would just help me so much.
It would help a lot.
Oh, the other thing I was going to say was, I love how different this live performance is to the one that she did at the Country Music Awards.
Yes, I was thinking that too.
It's such a different vibe. Like,
it is.
There's something about this room and the three of them together that is just such a folklore vibe. Like, just the way Aaron plays his guitar and the way that Jack kind of adjusts his playing style to Aaron, I feel like, in when they're playing together, and it's just got Aaron all through it, I feel like.
Yeah.
Whereas when Taylor's on stage singing Betty by herself, like, it was a different vibe to this. And
I completely agree. It's a different vibe from that live version.
This whole performance is.
Yes, I completely agree.
Oh, peace. That's what we're forgetting.
That's right. I was like, there is something wrong here.
Yes.
When you sent me this instrumental, the first word that I thought of was this is what peace sounds like.
Oh.
It's got this, you know, this amazing bass.
That's so
line
lovely.
That just made me feel like this is serenity, this is peace. And then I was thinking, maybe you just start with the obvious and think about how that could be told in an interesting way that kind of goes against the title. Like, I could never give you peace.
She's so good.
Over the most peaceful sounding instrumental.
It's kind of like same
track.
Energy as happiness.
Yes.
And not being
you
about happiness.
Kind of
yeah,
kind of
thing.
Everything, including like the most off the wall idea you have. And then you were able to write a song which not only does it like have such a beautiful, it's such a beautiful love song and recognition that of the kind of like insecurity in any relationship that like, will I be able to give you peace? Will you be at rest with me even though, you know, whatever comes? But you also trace the bridge, when I heard the bridge and that you traced all the weird timing and weird
you can tell how concerned he
like,
is.
Okay, we can do anything. We might be able to do anything or something. You know, like this is a, like it pushed the collaboration forward at that moment where I was like, okay, so this is a weird race. Let's just.
If you're going to be in my life, I feel like there's a certain amount that comes with it that I can't stop from happening.
Yeah.
I can't stop from you getting a call in the morning that says, you know, the tabloids are writing this today. And so this song was basically like, is it enough? Is the stuff that I can control enough to sort of block out the things that I can't?
Yeah.
It's so concerning to hear her talk about peace again in this light, because we already know it's just one of her most vulnerable songs ever. But to have her lay it out like that again, it just hits the heart so much, because I can't believe she gave this song to us. And once again, it's because of fucking Aaron. Thank you so much for giving her that track. What he said about her going over the bridge like that with the kind of chaotic melody is so true. Like, I feel like the melodies in Folklore and Evermore are so unpredictable sometimes and so creative that it really does feel like you just don't. He's like, anything is possible.
Anything is possible.
And that's really what
he probably never believed
like.
That anyone would be able to match him with what he created there, and yet she consistently does.
It's he can't even.
And that
do
would
it.
Be mind blowing. No,
even
he can't even
lyrics.
Do it. No.
Which
it's
is
mind
blowing. What's so amazing about their collaboration.
Yes, and their chemistry together. You're right. It's like they just work seamlessly together. It's perfect.
It's absolutely wild.
It makes me really like. Really emotional to hear this song and to know that a lot of people related to it who aren't talking about the same things that I'm talking about.
Mm.
They're talking about human complexity.
Mm. Yeah, I love that about the record in general and this song specifically, because to me it's about, I have in my life suffered from depression and I'm a hard person to be in a relationship with or be married to because I go up and down and I can't help it. It's like a chemical thing that happens sometimes.
That was such an amazing conversation.
It was, and that's so true of any relationship. You're always going to have these flaws that you just kind of like, is that worth the gamble for you? Because like everyone's going to be tricky to, in some and capacity like, even, to be in a relationship with.
Yeah. Exactly. It's actually amazing that Aaron talks about that because I feel like, you know, he's such a sweet, lovely, like understanding guy. And like you look at him and just think he would be like the most beautiful partner. And I'm sure he is.
Yes.
But then like for him to admit to that, like it just helps you see like the different things that everyone is going through and the different struggles that every relationship has.
Totally.
Yeah, and I love that conversation between the two of them.
Same, that was a great conversation.
So made it feel so relatable and the song more relatable.
Yes, 100%. And I love that even like that his perspective was like from like his experience with depression and stuff like that.
Yeah, I loved hearing that. I love hearing Aaron's perspective of the songs because like obviously he's written the sounds but then Taylor's given lyrics that he then
It's not just Taylor's lyrics that we're there to listen to. No. You know, like this song holds meaning for him in some other way as well.
Absolutely. Your integrity makes me seem small. I actually think this is the most similar.
I agree. I agree. Even what the, how he's playing it.
Yeah.
I agree.
To the original. Wow. Thank you so much.
Sure. You can just be able to do that.
That is so random, but so perfect.
So perfect. And then just coming back in with the guitar. Sit with you for the fences. Sit with you in the trenches.
Give you my wild. Give you a child. So concerning. Give you the silence that only comes when two people understand each other. Family that I chose never to see you, brother, as my brother. Is it enough? This song is... No. Because it's robbers to the east, clowns to the west. Oh, I see you in the eye.
Okay, the word house is another word that I love because I love that it has an X and I love the way that it looks and I love the way it sounds. I think with this song being the last song on the album, it kind of embodied all the things that this album was thematically, like confessions, incorporating nature, emotional volatility and ambiguity at the same time, sort of love that isn't just easy.
Mm.
And it's the most kind of
I love that.
Symbolic, poetic thing, listing all these things that this person is to you.
Mm.
And I remembered I asked you for advice on this one.
You did. I think you didn't. I think, like, to you it meant different things, and that was a moment of, like, doubt or something.
And I said, I think I said...
That's so interesting to hear, because I feel like that with Hoke sometimes. Like, I feel like it was the longest... It took me the longest to get my head around, in the sense of, like, what it actually... What she was actually talking about, And I think sometimes that's why maybe I am less drawn to it is because, like, I find it hard to put in a box. But I think that's what they're going to go into is, like, that it does have different meanings and it kind of bounces back and forth from different topics and, like, and it's kind of just, like, more of an expression of the feelings rather than, like, a specific topic.
Yes, or a specific storyline or whatever.
Yeah.
Not all of these feelings are about the same person. Yes. What if I'm writing about several different very fractured situations, like... You know, one is about love and one is about a business thing that really hurt, and one is about a sort of relationship that I consider to be family, but that really hurt. And
I remember
that's interesting because she, like, that's kind of her top touching on. Like, I feel it's the closest that she gets to kind of saying Scott and Scooter.
Totally, which is
Scooter's the business thing that really hurt, and then Scott is the family, like, what, something like family that fucked her over.
Totally, and I do feel a lot of the Scott situation in Hoax, I think. Like, at first, when we first listened to her, I remember in our reaction, we were like, oh my God, her and Joe broke up.
Yeah.
But, like, no, again, like, even just coming to the end of watching this, like, I just feel like... that it would have just been so valuable to have a version of this for Evermore. Like, I'd love to hear her talk about her perspectives on songs from Evermore. Like, there is so much I'd love to know about Gold Rush. There's so much I'd love to know about Ivy. There's so much I'd like to know about Cowboy Like Me.
Same.
Burninger, often songs are about more than one thing or many songs.
Coney Island. I would love to hear what they say about Coney Island. Him mentioning Matt just reminded me of that.
That would be fucked up.
So fucked up.
I kind of like the fact that you weren't totally sure.
I definitely had the moment of doubt. I had the moment of, like, I don't usually do this. I usually know exactly what I'm writing about.
Oh, that's so interesting.
And I was really happy when you kind of pushed me forward, like, nope, do the thing that makes you comfortable, because I think that's what makes it a song that really, to me, stands out. I think the part that sounds like love to me is, don't want no other shade of blue but you, no other sadness in the world would do. Mm. Yeah. It sounds like, to me, that sounds like what love really is. Mm. Like, who would you be sad with? And who would you deal with when they were sad? And like, gray skies every day for months, would you still stay?
Yeah.
Mm. Well, that's, yeah, that's, yeah. Mm. Yeah.
My only one, my smoking gun, my eclipsed sun, this has broken me down. My only one, my kingdom come undone.
That's my favorite lyric.
My
kingdom come undone.
Why?
Because I feel like she's made so many references to fairy tales and kingdoms and stuff in past lyrics, and I just feel like it's really like metaphorical of like everything that happened in like her life falling apart.
Yeah.
And like her, but also in relation to her career.
Yeah.
No other sadness in the world would do.
I think the lake sort of sounds like a testament of what I wanted to escape from and where I saw myself escaping. We'd gone to the Lake District in England a couple years ago.
What is the Lake District?
It's in England, and it's, you know, in the 19th century, you had a lot of poets like William Wordsworth and John Keats would spend a lot of time there. And there was a poet district, these artists that moved there, and they were kind of heckled for it and made fun of for it as being these eccentrics and these kind of odd odd artists who decided that they just wanted to live there. And I remembered when we went, I thought, man, I can see this. You know, you live in a cottage and you've got wisteria growing up the outside of it, and Hoax as the ending song for the record, I thought, was interesting for a couple weeks, but then I wanted to actually come in with the real last song of the record, which is this song that, The Lakes, which shows you exactly what, it kind of is the overarching theme of the whole album, of trying to escape, having something you want to protect, trying to protect your own sanity, and saying, look, they did this hundreds of years ago.
Yeah.
I'm not the first person who's felt this way. They did this.
Oh. It's a really potent statement right now. I think the idea of getting away and figuring out how to remove the things that are not working in one's life is the story of this time.
Yeah.
If you're not thinking about that, I don't know what you're thinking about.
The Lakes really is fucked up in that way. Like, for her to be able to, like, recognize that, like, she relates to these people from, like, a couple hundred years ago. It does make sense for her, for that to be something that she wants, and for that to be like her escape during like the middle of the pandemic, and to relate that back to like poets, which I feel like she is, even if other people don't like necessarily view her in that light because of like, you know, her being like a pop star and whatever.
Yes, yes.
Like, I think that's what's, and like he just said as well, like finding someone that you want to do that with as well is really special.
Yes. And we've talked about this a lot, about how like The Lakes is so special because we feel like she's managed to find that balance of escaping and also still managing to like be Taylor Swift and be so successful in her career. She has this really great balance now, that where she keeps a lot to private. She does have these escaping moments with Joe and moments alone, and it seems like she's really happy.
In some ways, Folklore itself was an escape, being that it wasn't so much more autobiographical and stuff. Like, there is a way for her to escape without it necessarily being physical.
And even it not having any pressure of structure to the album in terms of, like, having singles and, you know, a tour kind of album. Like, I think just everything about it was so creatively free.
Yeah.
And this is such a beautiful... is such a beautiful performance of this song.
Yeah, this is quite different from the original. Yeah. I love it. It's like in its own way.
Wait, can we believe that we got the fucking Lakes original? I forget that exists sometimes, that dark version.
Oh,
and it's
I actually watched that video again a few weeks ago. It actually is just such an interesting version. Like, what the fuck?
I love that some people prefer it. It's funny that she gave us that. Was that for the 1 year anniversary of Folklore that she gave us that?
Yeah, it would have been.
She literally didn't even acknowledge
it. It would have been.
See, I wouldn't be offended if she didn't do so much for Folklore.
No, I agree. Well,
like,
I've come too far to watch some name dropping sleaze. Tell me what am I waiting for?
It's like, I am not copying your shit at all.
I actually can't believe she wrote that lyric.
I know. And the word play on words, yes, it's so illegal.
It's unbelievable. She's a genius. I can't believe she's wearing a plaid. That really fucked me up.
I know. So she'll be Evermore. It's literally put that coat on her and it's Evermore.
You're right.
Even the fringe and everything.
Yeah.
Evermore. Is she... But like the fringe, even in the back one? Yes. Illegal.
How dare she?
Don't they just, like get up and fuck off? I forgot about that.
And then she goes and gets drunk and writes to the
next season.
Long Pond's spectacular. That was lovely to revisit that.
That was lovely to revisit that. Especially on a gloomy kind of rainy day here as well.
Yeah, it was quite comfy.
Yeah. And it's also summer here, and Folklore's a summer album.
Yes. It's summery, but it's rainy.
Summery, but it's raining. That's exactly what the vibe of Folklore is, I feel.
Oh, it really is.
Yeah.
I think I'm going to continue to listen to Folklore.
I think so too. Might even be the Long Pond
version.
Which I was actually just thinking, like, this whole video, like, I actually want to make a separate playlist that just has the Long Pond version. I hate how the Long Pond on Spotify has the original album and then the Long Pond one.
What?
Like,
why?
We have the
original album. Why would we want that?
I don't need this.
Can someone tell Taylor?
It actually doesn't make any sense. It's
really annoying.
It's like how the original Fearless had the bonus tracks first and you're just like, what?
That was concerning and wrong. Well, thanks so much for watching, guys, and thanks for coming back into the new year.
Yes.
I hope this 2020 got to you.
Taylor Swift year. It's a Taylor Swift year.
It's 22. Another Taylor Swift year. Taylor Swift owning our entire existence.
Can you believe the albums we're going to get this year?
No. I don't even know.
Who the fuck knows what's coming next? For all we know, it could be debut, but look.
Yeah, look, we really think that Speak Now is coming next. That's our next guest, because we don't think that she'll do 1989 after Red, because it will...
Two big albums next to each other feels a bit chaotic. Yeah. We need to go back to like a bit more of a mellow vibe. Yeah. Speak Now.
Oh, no.
Because
no,
I will
no,
be
no,
deceased
no, no,
when
no,
I hear no, a 1989 vault track. Just one. Just one. Just I don't one. Even need the fucking supposed... How many? 20 or some shit that there is? Like, I don't
no,
even
I
know.
I actually think I hit an emotional breakdown threshold with All Too Well, but we'll see.
Yeah,
we can always break through to new. We were like sobbing.
I think I actually can't believe there's gonna be 1989.
Anyway, let us know what video you guys would like to see next.
Yeah,
because
while we're in this bit of a lull of Taylor
really
Swift
sure
content,
if we should explore another artist, like whatever the top comment is, we will make the next video.
Yes, that's a great idea. Love that. Yeah. Yes, good idea.
It can be anything. Yes. It can be another artist. We've been thinking about going into Lana Del Rey. We've been thinking about even going...
Melodrama.
Lord. We want to do a Fleetwood Mac video.
We do. And then we've also not visited, which a lot of you have asked about, like Miss Americana and stuff as well.
Yes.
So there are
the visual stuff tends to be a little bit harder for us to react to, but we can definitely do that if you guys want.
Yeah.
We will do Reputation Stadium Tour when closer to the re-release of Rep. We're going to revisit
because
that.
Because we have already done a Reputation Breakdown, so that won't
we'll
be coming
that
prior
to
the
Rep.
I think so. I think so. That's a good idea.
Such an offensive tour.
And, you know, possibly even 1989 tour.
I think we should do that in the lead up to 1989. Yeah.
Yes.
But
yes.
until Blondie tells us what our next job is,
we will halt we've gotten it wrong. And
we don't
want to
release a Speak Now breakdown if that's not where we're going. You know what I mean?
No, like, absolutely
we want to do it so that
we're all on the same energy at the same era and all of that.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Kind of, I agree.
It was chaotic when we did the 1989 breakdown and then we got Red.
So
I'm not doing
chaotic.
That again.
No, absolutely not. Okay. Thank you so much for watching.
Bye.